Did you know that every eighth person in the world has played a game made by Swedes? Oh, but Sweden, aren't they too busy shopping at IKEA or dancing to ABBA? Wrong. Well, they do all of those things too. From the front line of the battlefield, to the mining and building of worlds, to finding out what it's like to wreak havoc as a goat. Sweden is responsible for a lot of visionary games. But I'm not gonna start bragging about stats, like telling you how many people play Candy Crush every month.
100 million.
It's not like I can convince you to become a part of the Swedish games industry by showing you these numbers, telling you exactly why there's never been a better time to do so. Take it from this Swede instead.
Yeah, it's true.
See? Told ya. So, if you're interested in belonging to a community with diverse people focused on bringing the highest level of creativity to a fan base, that in turn allows this business to be one of the most profitable in the world, I'd start thinking about becoming a Swede.
That's right. Yes. Yes. Our little secretariat can make cool things too. Not as cool as the games that the members make, but still. All right. So let's see some numbers. Johanna, I have with me my colleague, and she's the head of policy and analytics at the Swedish games industry, Johanna Nylander, and you are the author of the report Swedish Game Developer Index, this report. And I think you've all had the chance to grab copies. There are more copies outside. It's the best read, I was about to say century, but that would maybe be too much. The best read today. Johanna.
Thank you. So, yeah, this video, we will probably need to make a new one because some of the numbers are out of date already. But yes, I will talk about the games industry in Sweden. But to start with that, I want to go back to 2010. And in 2010, just a decade ago, Battlefield Bad Company 2 was the most sold game in Sweden. I think it sold 9 million copy that year, or the most sold game made in Sweden. That's right. It's by DICE, an EA studio in Stockholm. And while the Battlefield franchise still lives, I want to take a look at the data, how the industry looked back then, and like I said, just 10 years ago. Then we had a national turnover in Sweden for around 130 million euros. So that was how big the games industry was back then. And we thought that was, we were starting to growing a bit as an industry. That's, oh, now we are in Swedish kronors, we became like a billion industry, and that's huge in a way. The same year, the companies made a profit of 1.7 million euros. So that's not as much, but it was still, we were profitable. And I think it's also important to highlight that we were a profitable industry, and we have been so for the last 12 years now. And in the country, we had 115 game companies, game studios making games, small and big one. I think DICE was the largest studio back then. It has been for several years. Now there are three companies, so are almost the same size. And we were 1,203 employees. So we were growing. We were over 1,000 people in Sweden making games. That was big back then, in 2010. So take a look at how it's going and how we are today. The Game Developer Index report are based on data from last year, just so you know. So from 130 million euros, we're up to 3.3 billion euros. And that's one nice thing about the euro currency exchange rate is that in euros, we actually grew 43% from last year. In Swedish krona, it was just 41%. So even if we have the euro against us, we are still growing strong. And compared to other countries in the EU, we are in the top three, at least. We are now 667 companies in Sweden. Most of these are small. We are, I think it's 35 companies with a turnover over 100 Swedish million kronors. That's around 10 million euros. It's around 87 companies, something like that, with more than 10 employees. But we are growing, and a lot of the smaller companies are also indie developers and newly founded companies who are starting their journey on making games. A lot of the companies that we had back in 2010 still exist today as well. So we don't have a large turnover of companies, but they are still here, and most of them are still have games out on the market. We are now 6,596 people working in Sweden, or we're probably over 6,600 now, because I know some studios have hired since then. These are numbers from the end of the year 2020. We are growing strong. These numbers are not rising as much as turnover or and the money numbers, and as also said, to find talent is one of the main challenges for the natural industry. I can also say that we are over 7,000 people working for a Swedish game company living in other countries. One of them is, of course, Germany. We are over 1,410 women working in the industry as well. And this is equivalent to 21%, a bit over that, 21.4%, I think. It's growing both in how big share of the industry of women, and also in numbers, but not as much since the industry is growing as well. So just to repeat, this is what happened in 10 years in the Swedish industry. And yeah, it's a lot. We have a revenue, this year we have a revenue of 720 million euros. It's a bit more than those 1.7 in 2010. And what is it about Sweden? I think one point that's really important to highlight is that not everything in Sweden is in Stockholm or in the area around the capital. We have a lot of companies outside of the capital. We have several clusters, in regional clusters in Malmö and Skåne area. We have a great cluster up in the northern part of Sweden, Skellefteå, with Västerbotten, Luleå. Luleå, Skellefteå, Boden, and Umeå, I think. So if you like to ski or really enjoy really, really long, dark winters and really, really sunny summers, that's the place for you. And also in Karlstad, in Linköping, in several other places, we also, they are starting to grow more more clusters of companies and more local ecosystems for creating games. And that's also a way for the industry to grow inside of Sweden. But as I said before, and I probably should have included a map here of all the Swedish-owned studios in the world, but you can find it in the report, so that's something to see, because we have... What we can see that companies have done is to really try to also find other studios and other and to invest and acquire companies all around the world. And as Per said earlier also, that Sweden is the largest, or the ambassador said it even, Sweden is the largest investor in the German games industry. What has changed from during these 10 years as well is that we now have several larger companies. That's the base for the growth of the industry. We're not depending on a single company to really drive the industry. I know that, was said earlier here today, that the German industry consists of several smaller companies. I think we have a really broad variety of game studios and game companies in Sweden. And one thing I think has benefited Sweden is that our home market is really, really small. We don't have 80 million people to cater to. We need to go internationally from the start to be able to live off our games. And that's in this industry, I think that's a good way to start. And as an industry also, we are a very profitable industry. A majority of the Swedish companies are making profit, and it has been so for the last, I think the last 12 years, I said before. But the main reason why we are so successful in a way is also because people love Swedish games. We did a calculation and we came up to 6 billion downloads of Swedish games, and I think we now can say that almost every fourth person in the world has played a Swedish video game. So that's definitely something to be proud of, I think. But it's the games. It's the games that matter. It's the games that makes us good, and without the games we wouldn't have been a successful industry. If it is the long dark nights during winter, or if it's the fact that we don't have a home market, I'm not sure. Maybe it's both. When listen to the Stefan earlier about the German support system for games, I often think about how great would we be if we had the same sources of public support, especially when it comes to smaller companies to be able to start their dream and to make even more by the way. But yes, this is just a handful of all games created in Sweden, and we have a big variety of games and studios, and I think we create games for almost every major platform and every major genres in all of the sizes, basically. And yes, I think that's it for now. Thank you. And find the report.
Thanks, Johanna. Thanks for also for putting all the time in and crunching all those numbers in that huge database of annual reports and you get the chance to ask a question. I'll just want to ask my question first. What is the driver of this huge growth? 41% or 43%? 43% sounds a lot better. Also because I think 42% was the previous record. So in Euro, it was a record year in 2020. Yes. Yeah, make a note of that. But is it a pandemic or what's the reason for this particular boost?
I think the pandemic has definitely affected at least some companies in the way that I think at least in the early days of the pandemic, more people found games, and I think many people found new games as well to play, and games became like one of the few entertainments, especially younger children could do. And how they could communicate and be meet their friends. So I think that's of course has played its part, but on the other hand we have seen downsides of that as well, with longer waiting times and longer production times, because that's also a challenge with teams and culture and everything we have been talking about today. So I think, and then also we have the fact that in more of the evolved Swedish companies who have been like forming company groups and invested in studios in other places and brought them into the Swedish happy family. That's also, I think, one of the reasons behind it. But I think in general, what we can see is that we have several successful cases and several successful companies during the year. So we can't see, like, I can't point on like that Embracer, because even without Embracer, which had like 800 million turnover last year, we would still have an increase.
Amazing. So it's a wide variety. It's the pandemic, it's acquired growth, it's organic growth, a number of reasons. All right, I now invite you, dear audience. This is your chance. Okay, great. Let me do my little microphone dance. And Malte Biermann once again.
Yeah, thank you very much. Very interesting. Very, very interesting. Very impressive. I think we know each other for at least 15 years, and we started out together a little bit the same, Germans and Swedish, with the same conditions, and you just made much more out of it, we have to say. And I remember in the early days, maybe this is a good introduction to the statement, we had looked at Canada and said, Canada is so successful, and what do they write? And then I remember I was talking with a guy from Canada, you know well, also Jason De La Rocca, and he was telling me, it's not the funding system at all. The Canadians are just more talented than your Europeans. And I think that we should not have this misunderstanding that there is some kind of truth in this. So I think one important point is that the Nordic Game Program was set up just 10 years earlier than our funding program. So now you have less public funding, but you had public funding in the early days when this industry started to get moving earlier than in other places in Europe. And I think that was very important at that point in time. So we are a little bit later. Second point, which is, I think, really important, is the mobile shift. Because you have companies like Ericsson, also in Finland, you have these companies in the Nordics, which have been built mobile phones. And so you had many people who were actually coming from this mobile engineering sector and able to understand the mobile shift much faster than anyone else. I think that was very important. But I think the most important thing, and that's probably the real answer why the Swedish are ahead at the moment and why they are also so good investors in Germany, is because the Swedish capital circuit actually works. It kind of started going, and now it actually works. The investors who invest in the games industry in Sweden have rising capital, and you have a positive feedback loop, and suddenly you have an economy growing and growing very fast, and that's very successful. And one of the points is we had discussed this 15 years ago already, that you trust each other better, that you have a small community in the Nordic countries. It's cold outside and you have to trust the few people around, because otherwise you will be pretty alone. In Germany, we are much more people. It's just more densely populated, so we can easily just say fuck off and meet the next person, and it doesn't really matter so much, because so we are a little bit rougher. Yeah, the more densely populated a country is, the rougher it becomes in the tone. That were my remarks.
Thank you very much, Malte. Thank you. Yeah, it's interesting. I'm tempted to comment on all of that, but let me just say that it's also a great Christmas song. It's cold outside. anyone else? You will have more opportunity. All right, Martin. There will be a panel, and Johanna will also be on the panel, and I will take some of the points that Malte made and bring them to the panel. Martin.
Do you think next year will be as good, or will there be a post-pandemic backlash?
I definitely don't want to promise a 40% growth next year. I would be really, really surprised if we had that. However, I don't see any of the major companies going backwards. I think we will continue seeing growth. It's also the fact that actually this year or during the last 3 or 4 years, we had a couple of really big Swedish companies that were acquired by American companies, both Mojang, the Minecraft maker, and King, Candy Crush maker. And they now, their economy or finances are now more integrated in the larger parent companies. So, which means that they have like settled a way in how they are showing their Swedish finances, and we are looking at the Swedish finances public records. And despite of that, we are still increasing and growing stronger, and we have more companies that have been more successful. Studios are still looking for more people to hire, and I think what we'll see with, especially with employees, we have had like a steady 500-600 new people in the industry, and as long as that number is growing, I think we are pretty solid going forward.